All right, so we're here this morning at the Wharfinger Building on Pier 3 to highlight an innovative partnership between the city, the town of Fairhaven, MassDEP, the Harbor Development Commission, the Coast Guard, and the commercial fishing industry. As we all know, New Bedford is the colossus among fishing ports on the East Coast, the largest fishing port in the United States in terms of the value of its annual landings, and we are very bullish about our industry and support it wherever, however we can. It's an important economic engine for the city. Of course, the landings in the last year, for which NOAA has data, were $329 million. That was in 2014, and we've got a lot of vessels on the waterfront, and some over 400 active vessels, some most of which are homeported here, others that who have come in from other places. And because of that activity, and this is one of the busiest ports just in terms of the sheer amount of coming and going of any harbor in the country, really. We don't have a huge cargo business, unlike a lot of ports, but we do have, because of the size of the commercial fishing fleet, there's a lot going on. That means that we have to be vigilant about protecting the environment. And one of the risks that we have as a port has to do with oil spills. So we have, according to recent Coast Guard data, there's been at least one recorded small spill in New Bedford Harbor in each month since 2010. And one of the big sources of that contamination has been bilge water that has been pumped out of into local water. Now, I will hasten to add that we believe that even those numbers are far down from what historically had happened in the harbor, where it had been somewhat routine for vessels to empty their bilges out into local waterways. I think that practice had improved over the years, but we have seen a need to improve it further still, because even though New Bedford's an industrial harbor, we still need to keep it clean for lots of reasons, for environmental reasons, for community quality of life reasons. And so, like with everything else in New Bedford, we don't ignore our challenges. We take them head on. And this is no exception. We have gotten together over the last year or so a very strong coalition of folks to take a deeper dive into the matter. And we looked first for support from our friends at the Buzzards Bay Coalition, which are the stewards of our local waterways, and who I've worked with for many years, both in my capacity as mayor and before then, on a number of projects, and at the helm for a long time is Mark Rasmussen, the executive director, who will speak in a second. But through Mark's leadership and the leadership of the agencies that I just listed, we came up with a very innovative solution to the problem of oil spills, and it's called the Clean Bilge Program, and the idea is that in order to effectuate preventative efforts in the area of oil spills, we need to get people on board vessels to make sure that we nip the problem in the bud. It is tempting just to assume that we can enforce our way out of the problem, to find people who spill oil, to use a stick rather than a carrot, but that only takes us so far. What we need to do is we needed, I think, a partnership with the industry, and that's what we've had. So we enlisted the help of Rodney Avila, who you'll hear from in a moment, who will go into some detail about his efforts. But Rodney is a fourth generation fisherman. Where's Rodney? Fourth generation, right?
Fifth.
Yeah, you're number five.
I'm number five.
All right, so six generations in this family in the commercial fishing business. Everybody knows Rodney on the waterfront. So Rodney in many ways was a, to borrow a line from Ghostbusters, was the key master. He got everybody, he got in. And he's somebody that everybody trusts, and really, I think, helped deal with the problem head on, but also was an entry point into further into the problem, because people, Ronnie's a guy that people would let on their boats and talk about this problem. I think the problem, as he'll go into in some detail, has been greatly ameliorated. Since the program began in October of 2015, so it's roughly 6 months ago, not even 6 months ago, more than 120 vessels have signed up to participate, and 48 vessels have had their bilges pumped, accounting for some over 14,000 gallons of oily bilge water that was recovered and properly disposed of and kept out of the harbor. 14,000 gallons. And that's pretty significant. As Mark would tell you, we have a history together with the Buzzard Bay spill, which was, you know, a different matter, but that was 98,000 gallons in a much larger waterway. So if you think about 14,000 gallons of not going into New Bedford Harbor, that's really a big deal over a short period of time. So, you know, I've always felt, and I know so many of you share this belief, that New Bedford Harbor is the primary economic asset of Greater New Bedford, all southeastern Massachusetts, and we've got to make it work. And that means investment. It means working with businesses, but it's also part of our approach is also to maintain the environment, to be good environmental stewards. And so, I want to thank everybody who's been involved in this. I'm going to call people up one by one just to weigh in, but I really do want to thank Ed Washburn, our port director, and the Harbor Development Commission, all the commissioners, Rodney, of course, Mark, Gary Moran, whom you'll hear from in a second from DEP, and everybody who's been involved. The Coast Guard, I want to acknowledge the help of the Coast Guard, the New Bedford's Detachment Commander, Lynn Shui-Schwin. I always screw up your last name, so I don't, but who's been on the ground here for a few months and is doing a great job with our Coast Guard detachment in the South End, especially in facilitating communications with the industry. It played a big part. And I also want to acknowledge the help of Mike Gomes, our fire chief, who has developed the city's capacity, grown the city's capacity to react to contingencies on the water very well. So I wanted to thank Mike as well for the fire department's participation in the program. So with all that, we're blessed with some very strong state partnerships, and that begins with an agency that we have a great relationship with here in New Bedford, and that's the Mass Department of Environmental Protection. And Gary Moran is here from the department. He's the Deputy Commissioner for Operations and Environmental Compliance. But I will tell you that Gary's not about, and I referred to the stick before, it's not, he understands that keeping the environment clean isn't just about enforcement, it's about working with communities to promote prevention. And so we really appreciate the partnership that we have with Gary, and I was asking you to come on up and say a few words. Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, and it is a pleasure to be here today on behalf of Governor Baker, Secretary Beaton of Energy and Environmental Affairs, and Commissioner Suberg at MassDEP. And as the mayor mentioned, it's also good to be here, not talking about the stick. So I know everyone thinks of a regulatory agency coming down, always being the thing you really want to see, but here, to suspend disbelief, we really are here to help. The mayor mentioned the spill, the Bouchard oil spill from April 2003, and most of us have been around long enough to remember what a tragedy that was, what a terrible event. It was a disaster for the region and for the natural resources here in the Bay. But looking for silver linings, there were a couple of positive things that came out of it. Clearly, there was an appreciation, renewed appreciation, recognition of the importance of the natural resources that the Bay is. And it also spawned new legislation, the Oil Spill Act, that really has provided the state the opportunity to support efforts to prevent and respond to oil spills in coastal waters throughout Massachusetts. The act allowed us to collect some small payments on every barrel of oil that transited Buzzards Bay, and we've really been able to use those monies to a positive end with communities all along Massachusetts coast, including here in New Bedford and the Buzzards Bay area. We've used those funds to develop site-specific response plans, the geographic response plans, to help coastal areas prepare for spills, providing local communities with oil spill trailers, all the equipment needed to address spills, help them deal with the cleanup, and the development of spill drills and training exercises. Obviously, we've worked with Buzzards Bay on the the coastal areas here, down in Buzzards Bay, developing the geographic response plans, testing those. These have all been really important efforts to help respond to spills when they happen, but it is great today to be here celebrating this new initiative, the Clean Bilge Program. That's a concrete measure to help prevent the spills before they happen. As Amir mentioned, we regularly see spills in the bay. There's been a steady increase over the years that of spills reported to the Coast Guard and MassDEP. And most of the time, the spill is not actually ever found. So this pilot project will really help us determine what the long-term solutions may be to the mystery spill problem that's been plagued the harbor for years. So we're really excited to support this outreach, this collaborative effort, work with our partners on these efforts to support things like posting all the information signs around the harbor with the phone numbers of who to call, what to do if you see a spill. Supporting the efforts of the outreach coordinator, Rodney, who can work directly with the fishermen, boat owners, to get them to commit to maintaining clean bilge, bilges by joining the Clean Bilge New Bedford or Clean Bilge Fairhaven programs, as well as providing the free inspection of boats, oil, and fuel systems, and helping make suggestions on how to improve their operations, avoid leaks. The funding from the Oil Spill Act also funds those, I think the pump outs, the bilge pump out services are free of charge to anyone who's in the program. And I think one other effort I should mention is it's a separate but related effort. We've been working with the oil companies that service the harbor to help them set up waste collection programs. There are some companies that actually have effective oil collection programs already, but it's really important if we can capture the waste oil before it gets into the water. When it's free from water, you can actually take off things like the antifreeze and recycle the material rather than have it go into the bay and pollute the area. So I'm happy to join you today. I have to say I'm pleased. I woke up in the middle of the night with the pouring rain, lightning, and thunder. I thought it might be an outdoor event. It's good to see the weather cleared up and we're not outdoors, but I also started coming to a working harbor. I really couldn't complain about a little bit of rain. So again, thank you for having me.
All right, thanks, Gary. All right, thank you, Gary. I think you make a really great point about the mystery spills. And one of the reasons enforcement doesn't work well, a traditional enforcement approach doesn't work well, is because detection is very difficult. We have had many spills in the harbor of unknown origin over the years. And so, you know, the effort here really is to add a cultural change to get folks in the habit of getting rid of contamination on their vessels before it ends up in the harbor. So I think that's really the number. So in any event, I want to call up Ed Washburn, our port director, who's been in the thick of this and so many other things, one of the many things on his plate these days, and for a few words about the program. Ed.
Mayor. Thank you very much, everyone, for coming. So as you all know, New Bedford is very much a working harbor, whether it's fishing vessels, larger commercial vessels, cargo vessels coming in. We've always been a working harbor, and because of some of the issues we've had with oily water, we've actually built up a very robust response using state, local, and federal, working with our state, local, and federal partners. So Chief on the local level, along with Timmy Cox, Dan and Andy from DEP, Lieutenant Lynn from U.S. Coast Guard. So the response portion of our over the last 5 years has really improved, and the times have improved. Our guys, sorry, Brian, Harbor Development Commission staff as well, the response times have really improved, and it's gotten to the point where instead of just responding, we're trying to become more proactive. And that's really what this program is. You know, we've worked with Buzzards Bay Coalition over the last 5 years really to focus on the harbor and how clean it is. And this is how we've come up with this more proactive approach. And the key to this program is really the industry involvement and the educational aspect of it. And I'm going to let Rodney sort of go into how he approaches the boat owners and interacts with them and what the real takeaways are once they get into the program. So Rodney, you want to come up?
Come on up, Rodney. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for coming today. It's an honor to be here. The mayor stole most of my thunder.
I do that to everybody, Ryan.
That's all right.
Nothing personal.
That's all right. I'm going to recapture it.
Good. It all bears emphasis.
All right. He said we have more than 120 boats. We have 127 boats. Okay.
I stand corrected.
Okay. This program started on October 9th, our first pump out in 2015. It was a slow start. We started with three vessels. Then it expanded. As the word got around, I started on the dock. That was my, one of my first days on the dock. And fishermen always thought there was a hook to this. They thought I was, there was going to be a back door with the Coast Guard to come in and find them. So I had to emphasize that this was not the case. The case, what we, our intentions here was to get the water out of the bilges before it ended up in the harbor or in the bay. Because then it hurts everybody. Hurts the environment, hurts the shell fishermen, and it hurts your family going down to the beach, and nobody wants to swim in oily water. So since that day, we've had 8 pump outs, total 48 boats out of the 127. A lot of boats are not really going to stop pumping out till they start fishing again, because a lot of the owners are not even here, especially the rich golfers. They're in Florida. They come back just before they start fishing. So what I'm dealing with is a maintenance man, and he has no authority to give me permission to go pump out their bilges. So as they come, I'll be getting calls. We have pumped out 14,117 gallons of oily bilge water. Today, we're probably going to be another 2,500 added on to that. 3,000 gallons of that has been direct oil, which is about 24% of everything we pump out. Like I said, this program has removed over 14,000 gallons already, and that oil will never be in water. It's gone. It's disappeared. It'll never end up in the harbor, either Fairhaven or New Bedford. So that's a good positive thing. The other positive thing is the culture is changing. Now, instead of me going beating on fishermen to pump out their bilges, they're calling me and saying, could you pump out your bilges? This morning, I've had 4 calls already for next week. Because as soon as they see that truck down there, they know I'm pumping out, and everybody wants to get put on the list. After I do the initial pump out, well, the initial pump out is I physically go on a boat, and I check their lines, I check their sight glasses, the fuel tanks, make sure nothing's dripping. Some of the older vessels have what we call the gate valves. That's a little gasketed valve, and with the number of times of turn it wears, and there's a little bit of leakage all the time. I recommend that they put ball valves in. Some of the boats have changed that. So I go and I inspect it, and part of the outreach is I'll interview the captains or the engineers, and I'll pass out our brochure, which is a nice brochure. It has everything we do here, and it has the numbers to call, the national response number. It has my number. And we also give them a decal which they can put in the window that they belong to this program, they're part of this program. We also have another one that they put inside with the numbers to call in case they see an oil spill, either in Fairhaven or New Bedford. Okay. I don't want to go too far because I know there's some other speakers here. So the commercial fishermen and boat owners, I believe in this program now. They're starting to believe in it. We need to keep our harbors oil free. And some of the other ports smaller than New Bedford already have a program similar to this in place. It may not be a big pump out truck, but it may be a place where people can get rid of their oily bilge water. So this is the biggest number one port. So we should have a program like this. Okay, thank you.
Okay. All right, thanks, Rodney. And this program has gotten off to a very fast success, and it is it's attributable to the partnership, but also to the fact that we have Rodney on board. He's been the tip of the spear on this project and has really made it happen. So
does that mean an increase in my salary?
No, it just means more thanks, Rodney. Just public acclaim is all we can offer you. Rodney has done a terrific job with this, and it's made a big difference. And it's great to hear that fishermen are approaching him for pump outs and not the other way around, and that's really, I think, speaks to the trust that he's been able to build, and that the notion that authorities aren't trying to go after fishermen, I think, is finally being understood. So that I think once that starts to continue to cement itself in the minds of folks who work on the harbor, the more that we'll be able to accomplish. So With all that, before I call up Mark, I want to call up Tim Cox, Harbor Master from Fairhaven, to say a few words. Now, it's often tempting to think of New Bedford Harbor as being just New Bedford, but it's also Fairhaven. Fairhaven has a big role to play in keeping the harbor clean. There are many active vessels on the Fairhaven side, and the waterways our environment certainly doesn't recognize municipal boundaries. So fortunately, we have a strong working relationship with the town, and Tim's done a great job over there and working with us. So I just ask you to come on up and say a few words. Nice stuff.
Appreciate it. Yeah, I don't have much to say. I just I think this Clean Bilge Act is a great thing that they've started, and I'm glad that New Bedford and DEP has made Fairhaven a partner in this. Again, we don't have as many working fishing vessels over in Fairhaven, but we do have a fairly large shipyard over there that does work on a lot of the boats from the New Bedford side over there, and we do have a few areas where commercial guys do dock their boats. So I just want to give kudos to everybody that is involved with the program. Rodney has done a great job on getting people involved. Again, in the beginning, he is right. It was, we'd get some phone calls on my side, hey, what's this all about? And we'd explain it to him, and Rodney would go over and talk to him. I know he hasn't done a ton of boats on the Fairhaven side, but he's done a few, and he said he's got a couple scheduled for next week. So again, thanks to everybody who's gotten everybody involved in just letting Fairhaven be a part of it is a great thing. Thanks to the fire chief of New Bedford, Chief Gomes, our fire chief over in Fairhaven. The both fire departments play a big role in the cleanups and getting DEP involved. And unfortunately, Andy lives in our town, and he's always my first reach out. So I do bother Andy a lot more than I bother a lot of other guys. But again, through the New Bedford Harbor Master, HDC, and us, I think it's a great program, and it's working. You've already seen, you can ask the guys, we've already seen a difference in since they've started this program about the mystery spills, you know what I mean? You're still going to get them, but it's not as occurring as it used to be. So I think it's a great thing. So thank you.
All right, thanks, Tim. All right, last time I called Mark Rasmussen, who's the president of the Buzzards Bay Coalition, and a big part of the drive for this came from the coalition, which is not surprising because the coalition has a tremendous track record of introducing new initiatives, new ideas to improve the quality of our water and local waterways for well over 20 years now, and Mark's leadership has been instrumental in making that happen, whether it's in the response to the Buzzards Bay spill or conserving wetlands around the region or in initiatives like this. These guys have done a tremendous job, and we're grateful for your leadership and the partnership with the coalition. Mark is newly married, so he's got that new married man glow about him as well to add to his resume. Mark, come on up.
All right, thank you, Mayor Mitchell. I won't speak for too long, but I do want to tell just a little bit of history around this issue. First off, to put it in the context of what's happening in Bedford Harbor. So we are, I think, all very fortunate to be the generation that is changing the culture around New Bedford Harbor. We have accomplished so much. Sewage overflows are down. The amount of trash that's floating trash in the harbor is down. We have volunteers who monitor water quality every week at stations throughout New Bedford Harbor. And last year, we kept on having them send back comments on their forms about how clear the water was. And we heard this from everybody around the region. New Bedford Harbor is starting to look better. And guess what happens when that becomes the norm? People expect it. When it starts to, when they start to see something happening, they call everybody on it. But one, there's a very difficult problem that hasn't sort of popped the curve like water clarity and smell have, is this issue about the mystery spills. I live on the harbor on the Fairhaven side, and it is still very common to come home from work and open the car door and smell diesel fuel. I know, Andy, we all see the same thing. And that is, none of my neighbors are up in the streets. They're not calling the selectman's office. I don't think the same thing's happening here in New Bedford. We accept that. We've come used to that in New Bedford Harbor. And that has to change along with all the other changes, and it is changing as a result of this program. But I want to recognize the city's role and DEP in sort of making a really big leap forward on this effort. So the very first time this problem shows up in a Buzzards Bay management or cleanup document is 1991. The regional plan for Buzzards Bay was signed in City Hall, and it listed as one of the priorities for New Bedford this problem. So that's 25 years ago. It was one of the things New Bedford was going to work on as part of the regional effort to clean up the bay. A few years later, 2000, DEP actually made a $150,000 grant to New Bedford to build a bilge oil recovery system on the dock. The city forfeited that grant. They didn't move forward at that time. In 2010, with a great leadership at HDC, we started to take a fresh new look at this. And I think when HDC and Buzzards Bay Coalition went to DEP and said, we still have this problem. We've all been looking at it for 20 years now. Can you help us solve it? We found a partner at DEP who really wanted to work with us, which is amazing. So the whole dialogue changed. And so that period between 2010 and 2015, the Coast Guard, Fairhaven, New Bedford, DEP, all sitting together to come up with this new solution, which is really wonderful. And I think the highlights here, everybody's hit on them, but I think we really need to underscore the fact that we have great support from the state. We have outstanding leadership here in the city, the HDC, Ed's leadership, but also Jeff Steve, his predecessor, was a big part of getting this going. And DEP, who was able to look at the Massachusetts Oil Spill Prevention Fund and say, you know what, we have a very unique situation. New Bedford is unique, it has special problems, and we're gonna apply this fund to sort of solve this problem. And to DEP's credit, particularly Dan Crafton, Mike, we have a lot of support at DEP to get this done. So with that, I guess I'll close with vessel owners. Culture change happens, you know, from the ground up. We can all talk about, like, as we have been, 25 years, people have been talking about this problem in New Bedford Harbor. Culture change comes from the bottom up, and it comes through the kind of contacts that Rodney's making. And these vessel owners who stepped up, and, you know, it is a dangerous, it's a nervous area for a vessel owner to step into. It involves pollution, it involves potential for fines. All these issues are touchy issues with any business owner. And instead of going at it with that enforcement stick angle, by going at it the voluntary way, we're seeing great response. But that doesn't happen if the vessel owners don't want it themselves. I mean, I think the 120 boat owners that have signed up for this program, 127, are leaders in changing this culture. And so the other boat owners are going to see why these boats are in. They're going to come on board eventually. And that's how we change this harbor over time. So I'm very happy to have been a very, very small part of keeping this discussion going and getting this problem addressed. And I couldn't be more happier than to see this 14,000 gallons of oil taken out of New Bedford Harbor over the past few months. It's really is extraordinary. So thank you.
Well done.
Thank you.
Thanks, Mark. Yeah. All right. Let me open it up for questions. Anybody?
Is this a piece of equipment there, and where did the money come for that?
You guys want to speak to that?
Yeah, so it's the program is mostly educational in this form. So that's really where you get most of the benefit is teaching. You know, when Ronnie talks about gate valves and ball valves, you know, that goes over most people's heads. But teaching the fishermen how to change their oil in a different way and that sort of thing is really where the impact happens. Another portion of it is, and you'll see it, there's actually a pump out happening as we speak, is actual physical going into the vessel with a pump truck and pumping it out.
And the funding
all came from the DEP oil spill fund.
Is that an annual grant, sir, or is it one time?
We hope so.
Keep it coming.
How long is this one for?
This grant extended for how long? This pilot program?
This next year or so.
Yeah, through the next year. So.
At least.
It is a pilot, so we'll see how it works. And then we can go back for the fund for another.
Right, yeah, this is considered a pilot.
Okay. Anybody else? Don, you no longer a reporter. You sure you don't want an inclined to ask a question?
What do you have to do to get the Green Build sticker, for instance?
Just Paul Rodney.
Great. Paul Rodney. You should get a 1-800 Rodney number or something.
No, I actually said against that. Fishermen no call 1-800.
All right. Thank you, everybody. I want to just thank everybody for the real good teamwork on this project. It really does make a difference. I think to Mark's point about it's tempting just to assume because it's a busy industrial harbor, it's okay for it to be contaminated. And the answer is, truthfully, it's not. And if we start to develop a culture of keeping things clean, it begets better behavior. We see it in the city. We've eliminated graffiti, and you know what? People stop putting graffiti on buildings after a while. There are exceptions, of course, but when we get it down, people are turned off by it, by doing just that. And I think the same can be said for other forms of pollution, as it were. So that's really important. And none of what we're doing here imposes on commercial activity in the harbor. It's not, you know, businesses aren't bearing some new expense in order for this to be successful. So we can promote commerce and keep the place clean all at once through a program like this. So I just want to thank everybody for their contributions in that way. Thanks.
Thank you. And there is an opportunity to actually see how it works right now. We can bring folks over to the, it's right on this pier, so you can go take a tour of the boat potentially, right?
This is one of the six commercial fishing vessels that we're pumping their bilges out today. This actually is vessel number five that we pumped out today. The most we've ever done in one day is seven vessels, but we try to get all the oil, all the oily bilge water out of the bilges before it ends up in the harbor or in the bay. It's a process of keeping New Bedford Harbor clean. It's a very good program. I think this is the best program that has been introduced to the fishing industry since I can remember. And I started fishing in 1957, so that's a good program.
Lunch, a sandwich is a quick and easy choice, and with the right ingredients, it can be good and good for you. So I'm here today to see who can build the ultimate sandwich. All right, when the time is up, our judges will give you their scores. Ready, set, go! Okay, Jason starts out with a multi-grain roll. Ooh, Allison stuffing her pita with, yes, spinach, a great source of iron. Jason isn't skipping on the protein, adding plenty of smoked turkey. Looks like Allison's putting the finishing touches with crispy red bell peppers for a dose of vitamin A. Time! It looks like we have a tie. We'll need to call in our special guest referee.
Now, these are what I call quick, delicious lunches. Whole grain breads, a whole variety of ingredients. There are so many different ways to build delicious, healthy sandwiches. These two get high marks in every category. I'd say you're both winners. America.
Let's get healthy together.
Yeah, that's right. I think my purse is upstairs on the bed. It's not here.
Check the dining room.
No.
What about your sister's room?
It's not there either.
The upstairs closet? The downstairs closet?
There are no more closets.
Moms everywhere are finding ways to keep kids active and healthy. Get ideas, get involved, get going at letsmove.gov.